It happened in a millisecond. A movement in the galaxies that should have taken eons occurred in the blinking of an eye. At the Cape Hattie Observatory, a young astronomer sat stunned, reaching an instant too late to activate the camera that might have recorded it. The splintering of three constellations that produced the dark, glowing star. From Capricorn, Cancer, and Leo, pieces had suddenly flown, finding each other with magnetic certainty, melding into a pulsating, galactic ember. He feared he was alone with it, but in fact he was not. For from the very bowels of the earth there came a distant sound. It was the sound of voices, human, yet not. Growing in devout cacophony with the heightening potency of the star. In caves, basements, and open fields they had gathered, midwives to the birth, some 20,000 strong. With hands joined and heads bowed, their voices rose until the vibration could be heard and felt everywhere. It was the sixth month, the sixth day, the sixth hour. The precise moment predicted by the Old Testament when Earth history would change.
The Omen by David Seltzer. Abridged by Jeremy Osborne. Read by Owen Teale.
In his first-class seat aboard the 747 bound from Washington to Rome, Robert Thorne routinely fastened his seatbelt, preoccupied with what awaited him below. The telegram he'd received in Washington was 12 hours old, and by now whatever had happened was over. He would find Kathy in a hospital bed nursing their newborn child, or in a state of despair for having lost it once again. The plane touched down on the runway. He remained in his seat as others groped for their carry-ons, crushing toward the door. He would be taken through customs into a waiting car. It was the nicest part of coming back to Rome, for here he was something of a celebrity. As the president's economic advisor, he was chairman of the World Economy Conference, which had been moved from Zurich to Rome. The initial four-week agenda had droned on now for close to 6 months, and in that time the paparazzi had begun to notice him. The rumor spreading that in a few years hence, he himself would be a U.S. presidential hopeful. As the taxi stopped short in front of the darkened hospital De Santo, Father Spoleto gazed down from his second-floor office window. Knowing in an instant that the man bounding out was Robert Thorne, the rugged jaw and graying temples were familiar from newspaper photos, even the attire and gait seemed familiar as well. It was satisfying that Thorne looked every inch of what he should. Plainly, the choice had been right. Drawing his robes around him, the priest stood and, without expression, moved quietly to the door. Thorne's footsteps could already be heard below, echoing as they moved vigorously across the bare, tiled floor. "Mr. Thorne." Below him, Thorne turned, his eyes searching upward in the darkness.
"Yes. I am Father Spoleto. I sent you."
The priest moved into a shaft of light and craned down the stairwell. There was something in his movement, the silence that surrounded it that signaled all was not well.
"Is the child born?"
asked Thorne.
"Yes." "My wife?" "She's resting."
The priest was at the base of the stairwell now, and his eyes met Thorne's.
"Something's gone wrong," said Thorne. "The child is dead." There came an awesome silence as Thorne stood paralyzed as though hit by a body blow.
The priest watched, unmoving, as the man before him walked stiffly to a bench and sat for a long moment.
then bowed his head and wept. Throughout the empty tiled corridors, the sound of weeping echoed, and the priest waited his turn to speak. "Your wife is safe," he said, "but she will be unable to bear another child."
"It will destroy her," whispered Thorn.
"You could adopt."
"She wanted her own."
In the silence that followed, the priest stepped forward. His features were coarse and composed, the eyes filled with compassion. Only a trickle of perspiration betrayed the tension hidden within.
"You love her very much," he said. Thorn nodded. "Then you must accept God's plan."
From the shadows of a darkened corridor, an aged nun appeared, her eyes imploring the priest to join her. They came together, whispering for a moment in Italian before she departed, and the priest turned again to Thorn. There was something in his eyes that made Thorn stiffen.
"God works in mysterious ways, Mr. Thorn."
He held out his hand, Thorn rising, compelled to follow. The maternity ward was dark and clean, the smell of babies renewing the sense of loss that throbbed deep in Thorn's stomach. Moving to a glass partition, the priest paused, waiting as Thorn hesitantly approached and gazed down at what lay on the other side. It was a child. Newborn. A child of angelic perfection, with thick black hair tousled above deep-set blue eyes. It stared upward, instinctively finding Thorn's eyes. "It is a foundling," said the priest. "Its mother died as your own child, in the same hour." Confused, Thorn turned to him. "Your wife needs a child," continued the priest. "The child needs a mother." Thorn slowly shook his head.
"We wanted our own."
"If I may suggest, it very much resembles..."
And Thorn looked again, realizing it was true. The child's coloring was the same as Kathy's.
"The Signora need never know," implored the priest.
And from Thorn's sudden silence, he took heart. Thorn's hand had begun to tremble, and the priest took it, infusing him with confidence.
"Are there relatives?"
"None." Around them, the empty corridors hissed with silence, a stillness so dense that it was assaulting on the ear.
"I am in full authority here," said the priest. "There will be no records. No one could know."
Thorn averted his eyes, desperate with indecision.
"Could I see my own child?" he asked.
"What's to be gained?" implored the priest. "Give your love to the living. For the sake of your wife, Signor, God will forgive this deception. And for the sake of this child, who will otherwise have no home." His voice fell to silence, for no more needed to be said.
The Thorns were both of Catholic parentage, but neither of them was religious. Thorn himself did not take seriously, as Kathy did, the fact that their son Damien was never christened. Kathy was intending one day to make sure it was done right. But that day never came, for they were swept into a whirlwind of distractions and the christening was forgotten. The economy conference had ended, and they moved back to Washington, Thorn resuming his duties as a presidential advisor and becoming a political entity unto his own. The Thorn family became familiar to readers of national magazines all over the country. They were photogenic, they were rich, and they were on the way up. And more important, they were often in the company of the president. It came as no surprise when Thorn was appointed the ambassador to the court of St. James. In London, they took up quarters in a 17th-century mansion at Pettiford. For household duties, there was a staff of day help and a permanent couple, the Hortons, who acted as cook and chauffeur. To To entertain Damien when Kathy was occupied with official chores, there was an English girl named Chessa. She was bright and full of play, and adored Damien as though he were her own. The child himself was growing into an artist's rendering of what a human child should be. 3 years since his birth, his health and strength were phenomenal. He had a kind of composure about him. Horton occasionally took him out on errands, enjoying his silent presence, amazed at the child's fascination with everything that went on outside. "He's like a little man from Mars," Horton once remarked to his wife, "like he was sent here to study the human race." "He's the apple of his mother's eye," she responded. "Wouldn't do you no good to be heard saying that." "I'm not downing him, just that he is a bit unusual." The only other troubling aspect about Damien was that he rarely used his voice. Kathy once inquired about this to her physician, but the doctor was most reassuring. He was only 3 and a half, and Albert Einstein didn't speak until he was 4. He was in every way the perfect child, the appropriate issue of the perfect marriage of Robert and Kathy Thorne. Haber Jennings was a paparazzi. He researched his subjects with the thoroughness of Jonas Salk, seeking the cure for polio. Lately, he had become fixated on the ambassador to London. He shuffled through piles of papers looking for the engraved invitation. It was to be a birthday party. The 4th birthday of the child. From all the poorest parts of London, busloads of children were already on their way. The entire estate had been turned into a sumptuous carnival. The lawns were teeming with colour and life, small bodies running between circus tents and carousels. Photographers ran everywhere, out of their minds with greed. But to Jennings, there was nothing there to photograph. Only the facade, the brick wall that everyone else took for reality.
"What's the matter, mate? Run out of film?"
It was Hobie talking, the stringer for the News Herald, feverishly reloading beside the hot dog table as Jennings casually approached and took a handful of food.
"Just waiting for his canonization," Jennings replied with distaste.
"How's that?"
"I don't know if we've got just the heir to the Thorne millions here or Jesus Christ himself."
"You're a fool to miss out, man. It's not often you'll get into a place like this."
"Why bother? What I need, I can buy from you."
"You want an exclusive, do you?"
"No other way."
"Well, good luck then. This is the most private family this side of Monaco." The exclusive. That was the Jennings dream.
All attention focused on a towering birthday cake being wheeled out from inside. The child's nanny, Chessa, was dressed as a clown, her face whitened with powder and painted with a garish red smile. As the photographers danced about her, she delighted in the attention, hugging, kissing, smearing her makeup onto the child.
"Can he blow them out?" they shouted. "Let him take a try."
Jennings' eyes travelled slowly through the crowds, and he spotted the face of the First Lady, Kathy Thorne, standing at a distance, a vague hint of disapproval playing about her mouth. For a split second, her mask was down, and Jennings instinctively reached for his camera, clicking off a shot. At the birthday cake, a howl of applause and approval went up, Kathy slowly moving forward.
"Tell his fortune," shouted a reporter. "Take him to the fortune teller."
And as a body, the crowd began to move, bearing the nanny and her adored child across the lawn.
"I'll take him," said Kathy, reaching toward them as they passed.
"I can do it, Mum,"
replied the nanny brightly.
"I'll do it," smiled Kathy.
And in the single moment of their eyes meeting, the nanny relinquished the child. It was a moment unnoticed by all, the momentum and noise carrying them forward, but Jennings was watching it through his viewfinder. As the crowd moved on, the nanny was left standing alone, the towering house framed behind her, the clown costume somehow accentuating her feeling of desertion. At the fortune teller's tent, Kathy admonished reporters to stay outside, then entered, breathing a sigh of relief at the sudden quiet and darkened atmosphere.
"Hello, little boy."
The words came from beneath a hood, an apparition seated behind a small green table, her voice strained to sound witch-like, her face made up in green. As Damien gazed down, he stiffened, climbing fast to his mother's shoulder.
"Come on, Damien," laughed Kathy. "This is a nice witch. Aren't you a nice witch?"
"Of course," laughed the fortune-teller. "I won't hurt you."
"She's going to tell your fortune," coaxed Kathy.
"Come on," gestured the fortune-teller. "Hold out your hand."
But Damien would not, clinging tightly to his mother. The fortune-teller lifted her rubber mask.
"Look, I'm just a person. This won't hurt a bit."
Relaxing, Damien held out his hand, Kathy sitting with him across the card-strewn table.
"Oh, what a nice soft hand. This is going to be a good, good fortune."
But she paused, gazing at the hand with confusion.
"Oh, I've never seen this before," she said.
"Seen what?"
"Look, no personality lines. All he's got is creases. Look at your own hand. Look at all the tracing. It's different with each person. These are marks of our identity."
There passed an uncomfortable silence, the child himself gazing at his hands, wondering what was wrong.
"Look how smooth his fingertips are. I don't think he has any prints."
Kathy looked closely. She realized it was true.
"Well," laughed the girl, "if he robs a bank, they won't catch him."
And then she laughed harder, Kathy gazing at the small hands in puzzled silence.
"Could you tell his fortune, please?"
Kathy's voice was uneasy.
"That's what we came in for."
"Of course." But as the young girl reached for the child's hands, they were interrupted by a voice from outside. It was Chessa, the nanny, and she was shouting from a distance.
"Damien! Damien!" she cried. "Come out! I've got a surprise for you!"
The fortune-teller paused, sensing, as Kathy did, a certain desperation in the cry.
"Damien, come out and see what I'll do for you!"
Exiting the tent with Damien in her arms, Kathy paused, gazing upward toward the house. There, poised on the roof, was Chessa, a heavy rope in her hand, cheerfully stretching it upward to show it was wound around her neck. Beneath her, the crowds began to turn, smiling in confused anticipation as the small clown moved forward to the edge and held her hands out as if readying for a high dive into a pool of water.
"Look here, Damien," she shouted. "It's all for you."
And in a single movement, she stepped off the roof, her body plummeting downward, snapped back up by the rope, then hanging limp. Silent. Dead. On the lawn they stood in stunned silence, the small body swinging gently to the accompaniment of a carousel waltz. The following morning, Kathy attended Chessa's funeral, taking Damien with her. It was a private affair conducted in a small cemetery on the outskirts of town, attended only by the girl's family, Kathy and Damien, and a balding priest who read from the scriptures while holding a folded newspaper over his head to ward off the persistent drizzle of rain. Fearing the publicity that would surround their presence, Thorn had refused to go, entreating Kathy to do the same, but her need was plain. She had loved the girl and needed to put her to rest. Outside the cemetery, a group of reporters milled about, prevented from entering by two United States Marines, dispatched at the last minute by Thorne from his staff at the embassy. Unseen among them was Haber Jennings, in black raincoat and heavy boots, positioned in the far trees, scrutinizing the proceedings through a long-distance lens. With careful precision, his telescopic view wandered from face to face. The family weeping, Kathy in a state of shock, the child beside her restless, his eyes roaming the bleak terrain. It was the child that captured Jennings' interest, and he waited patiently for precisely the right moment to snap his shutter. It came in an instant, a flickering of the eyes and a sudden change of expression, as though the boy had been suddenly frightened, then, just as suddenly, soothed. With his eyes riveted to a point far across the cemetery, his small body relaxed, somehow warmed in the midst of the cold, drizzling rain. Swinging his telescopic view, Jennings searched the landscape, finding nothing but headstones. And then something moved. A dark, blurred object, slowly coming into focus as Jennings racked his lens. It was an animal, a dog, large and black, its pointed face distinguished by narrow-set eyes and a lower jaw that protruded forward, exposing teeth, stark against midnight fur. Unseen by all others, it sat motionless, its attention fixed firmly ahead. As he packed his gear, Jennings felt satisfied, but somehow he was uneasy. At the top of a hill, he gazed back to see the coffin being lowered into the grave. The child and the dog were small in the distance, but their silent communion was plain. The following day brought a fresh onslaught of rain and the arrival of Mrs. Baylock. She was Irish and she was an outrage, pulling up to the front gates of Perriford and announcing herself as the new nanny. She bullied her way through, her boisterous manner at once intimidating and appealing. "I know it's a difficult time for you," she announced to the Thorns as she took off her coat in the vestibule. "So I won't impose on your grief. But between you and me, anyone who hires such a skinny young thing for a nanny is just asking for trouble." The movements of her massive frame were so vigorous that they created a breeze, Thorn and Kathy watching dumbfounded, silenced by her certainty. "Well, now, where's the boy?" I'll show you," said Kathy, indicating the stairs. "Why don't you just leave us alone at first? Let us get acquainted in our own way. He's a little shy with new people." "Not with me, he won't be. I can assure you of that. I really think... Let me give it a try." And in a moment she was climbing the stairs, her massive bottom disappearing from view. In the sudden silence left in her wake, the Thorns exchanged a glance, Thorn nodding an uncertain approval. "I like her," he said.
"I do too.
Where did you find her?"
"I didn't find her. I assumed you found her."
And after a moment's pause, Thorn called up the stairs.
"Mrs. Baylock."
"Yes?" She was already on the second story landing, her face peering down from above.
"I'm sorry. We're a little confused."
"Why is that?"
"Who called you?"
"The agency. They saw in the papers you'd lost your first nanny, so they sent you another." It seemed a bit opportunistic, but knowing the fierce competition for employment in London, Thorn thought it made sense. "Can I call to confirm that?" asked Kathy.
"Go right ahead," replied the woman.
The Thorns retired to the drawing room where Kathy called the agency and confirmed Mrs. Baylock's credentials. She was well qualified with high recommendations, the only confusion being that their file showed she was presently employed in Rome. It was likely, however, that her situation had changed without being entered in their files, and they would clear that up as soon as the agency manager, who no doubt sent her to the Thorns, returned from his four-week holiday. Kathy hung up the phone and gazed at her husband, and both shrugged. Rather pleased with what had transpired, Mrs. Baylock was an oddball, but full of life, and that, more than anything, was what they needed. Upstairs, Mrs. Baylock's smile had faded, and she gazed down through misted eyes at the child asleep in his bed. As the woman watched him, her chin began to tremble, as though she were standing before an object of incomparable beauty. The child heard her faltering breath, his eyes opening slowly to meet hers. He stiffened and sat upright.
Fear not, little one, she whispered in a faltering voice. I am here to protect thee.
In his cramped six-flight walk up in Chelsea, Haber Jennings was awake, gazing at the growing gallery of thorn portraits that adorned his darkroom wall. There were the funeral pictures, dark and moody, the close-up of the dog among the headstones, the close-up of the boy. And then there were the pictures of the birthday party, Kathy watching the nanny in clown costume alone. It was the latter photograph that most interested him, for above the nanny's head there was a kind of blemish, a photographic imperfection that somehow added to the potency of the scene. It was a fleck of faulty emulsion, a vague haze that hung over the nanny, forming a halo around her head and neck. Though normally a flawed photo would have been discarded, this one was worth keeping. The knowledge of what happened immediately after it was taken gave the blemish a symbolic quality, the shapeless form like a shadow of doom. The only shot he was missing was that of the ambassador himself, and Jennings hoped that tomorrow might be the day. There was to be a state wedding at the All Saints Church, which the Thorne family would likely attend. It wasn't Jennings' kind of setup, but he'd been lucky so far, and perhaps he would be lucky again. Massive front doors of the All Saints Church were always open. On this afternoon, the Gothic staircase leading to the doors was knee-deep in iris waistcoated ushers, creating a stately path. The event had brought a crowd of people, and the security guards had difficulty holding them back. The Thorne limousine was a late arrival, taking its position near the end of the block. The security forces were thin here, and people crowded around the car, staring unabashedly in. The mob thickened, and Damien, who had dozed, began to rouse, startled and confused by all the faces peering in. Kathy pulled him close, gazing uneasily ahead, but the bodies around them multiplied and began to knock as though trying to get inside. "It's all right," soothed Thorne, seeing the fear in the child's eyes. "These people can't hurt us. They just want to see who's inside." But the child's eyes began to widen. They were not focused on the people, but to a point high above them, the towering spires of the church. Thorne glanced at Kathy, directing her eyes to the child. His face was stone, his body tightening as the crowds faded and the church suddenly loomed into view. "It's all right, Damien," whispered Kathy. "The people are gone." Kathy gave Damien her hand and he clutched at it, gazing desperately into her eyes. The limousine stopped suddenly in front of the church and the door swung open, an usher's hand reaching in for Damien, sending him into more of a panic. Grabbing at Kathy's dress, he clung hard, beginning to whimper. As she tried to pull him off, he clung harder, becoming more desperate as she struggled. Thorne reached for him, pulling forcefully, the child fighting harder still to cling to his mother, his hands clawing her face and pulling her hair in his desperation to hold on. He began to scream in terror, a crowd gathering around them as they fought desperately within. Trying to help, Horton raced from the front seat, grabbing Damien and trying to pull him out of the car, but the child had become an animal, shrieking as his fingers dug deep into Kathy's face, a handful of hair ripping from her head. "Get him off!" she screamed. In terror, she began beating at him, trying to wrest the fingers that had dug into her eye. In a sudden move, Thorne ripped him off her, grabbing him in a bear hug and pinning his arms to his side. "Drive," he panted to Horton. "Get out of here." As the child struggled, Horton ran into the front seat, slamming doors as he went, the limousine lurching suddenly forward as it pulled fast away from the curb. The child's struggling slowly ceased, his head falling back in utter exhaustion. Horton swerved back onto the highway and in a few moments
All was silent. Damien sat with glazed eyes, his face wet with perspiration, and Thorn still clutched him in his arms, gazing fearfully ahead. Beside him, Kathy was in a state of shock, one eye swollen and nearly shut. They drove home in silence. No one dared to speak. When they arrived at Perryford, they took Damien to his room and sat him in silence as he stared out of the window. His forehead was cool, so there was no need for a doctor, but he would not look at them, fearful himself of what he had done. "I'll take care of him," Mrs. Baylock said quietly as she entered the room. As Damien turned and saw her, his entire posture registered relief.
"He had a fright," Kathy said to the woman.
"He doesn't like church," replied the woman. "He wanted to go to the park instead."
"He became wild," said Thorn.
"He was angry," said Mrs. Baylock, and she moved forward, lifting him in her arms. He clung to her like a child to his mother, and the Thorns watched in silence. Then they slowly left the room. Thorn moved stiffly out of the car, waiting there until it had pulled away, and then he saw them descending on him. Two men moving fast, one taking pictures, the other firing questions. Thorn headed toward the embassy, but they got in his way, and he tried to step around them, shaking his head in response to their questions.
"Have you read today's reporter, Mr. Thorn?"
"No, I haven't."
"There's an article about your nanny, the one that jumped."
"I didn't see it."
"It says she left a suicide note."
"Nonsense."
"Could you look this way, please?"
It was Jennings with a camera, moving quickly, clicking away.
"That's great. Just hold it like that."
The camera came too close and Thorn pushed it aside, knocking it from Jennings' hand. It crashed hard on the cement, and all stood for a moment in silence, shocked by the sudden violence of what had occurred.
"Can't you people have some respect?" gasped Thorn,
and Jennings knelt, gazing up at him from his knees.
"I'm sorry," said Thorn in a shaking voice. "Send me a bill for the damage."
Jennings picked up the broken camera and slowly stood, shrugging as he looked into Thorn's eyes. In Thorn's office, an intercom buzzed, and Thorn reached for it.
"Yes?"
"There's a father to Sony here to see you," replied a secretary's voice. "From Rome. He says it's a matter of urgent personal business."
"I've never heard of him."
"He says he just needs a minute, something about a hospital."
Thorn's doors swung open. He was a priest, his robes disheveled, his manner tense. His sense of urgency felt by all in the room. His eyes were sunken and etched with desperation, fixing on Thorn from across the room. Thorn's aides exchanged an uneasy glance, uncertain of whether or not to leave. Thorn, too, was disquieted, stiffening slightly under the man's intense gaze.
"Would it be all right," asked the priest, "to speak with you alone?"
Thorn nodded, his aides moving hesitantly from the room. When they were gone, the priest closed the doors behind them. Then he turned, his expression filled with pain.
"We have not much time. You must listen to what I say."
"And what is that?" asked Thorn.
"You must accept Christ as your Savior. You must accept him now."
There passed a moment of silence, Thorn at a loss for what to say.
"You must take communion," hissed the priest. "Drink the blood of Christ and eat his flesh, for only if he is within you can you defeat the child of the devil."
The atmosphere in the room burned with tension. Thorn's hand reached for the intercom buzzer and pushed.
"I've locked the door, Mr. Thorn," said the priest.
Thorn stiffened, frightened now by his tone.
"Yes?" asked the secretary's voice through the intercom. "Send for a security guard," replied Thorn.
"I was at the hospital, Mr. Thorn, the night your son was born."
Thorn was jolted.
riveted in place.
I was a midwife. I witnessed the birth.
The secretary's voice came again. Mr. Thorne, I'm sorry I didn't hear you.
Nothing, responded Thorne. Just stand by.
He released the button, gazing fearfully at the priest.
What do you want?
To save you, Mr. Thorne, so Christ will forgive me.
What do you know about my son?
I saw its mother.
You saw my wife.
Its mother, Mr. Thorne.
Thorne's face hardened and he gazed evenly at the man.
Is this blackmail?
He asked quietly. No, sir.
Then what do you want?
To tell you, sir, its mother, sir.
Go on, what about her?
With a sudden crash, Thorne's door flew open. A marine entering, Thorne's aides and secretary behind him. Thorne was ashen, immobile, the priest's face wet with tears. Something wrong in here, sir? Asked the marine.
You sounded strange, added the secretary. The door was locked.
I want this man escorted out of here, said Thorne, and if he ever comes back, I want him put in jail.
On the street outside the embassy, Haber Jennings leaned up against a car, checking out his spare camera, having put the broken one away. His eye caught sight of the marine escorting the priest down the front steps, and he snapped off a couple of shots of them as the priest slowly shuffled away. Later, Jennings sat in his darkroom gazing at a series of photographs, his eyes curious and confused. He had shot off a roll of 36 pictures at varying exposures and speeds, and three of them had turned out defective. It was the same kind of defect he'd had a few months ago in the shot of the nanny at the Thorne estate. This time it involved the shots of the priest. Once again it seemed to be a flaw on the emulsion, but this time it appeared more than once. It came twice in a row, then skipped two shots, then returned, exactly as before. Even more curious, it seemed linked to the subject. The strange blur of movement hanging above the priest's head, like a phantom javelin about to skewer the priest to the ground.
Jennings found his way to Thorne's office with no trouble. In all his years of stalking, this was the first time he'd ever made personal contact with his prey. It was easy to talk his way in, but now his heart was racing, his knees unsteady. Thorne stepped from behind his desk, moving to a bureau where he uncorked a bottle of brandy. Jennings watched him pour, accepting a glass.
You're looking for a relative?
Yes, sir.
He's a priest named Tassone.
He's a priest, but I'm not sure of his name. My mother's brother. Separated when they were children.
So you don't actually know him?
Thorne studied the man's face.
You see, I have a great interest in finding this man. The priest who was here. I'm afraid I was abrupt with him and I'd like to make amends. It's important to me.
By the look on Thorne's face, it plainly was. Jennings knew he'd stumbled into something, but he didn't know what. Tassone stood watching the ambassador from the opposite side of a chain-link fence, as Thorne and a group of dignitaries dedicated a housing project in a poor section of Chelsea. Thorne was a consummate politician, a man who enjoyed adulation, and as he moved by the fence, he made an effort to shake each of the greedy hands. But suddenly he was jarred, a hand reaching through with sudden violence and grabbing him hard by the shirt front, pulling him close to the fence.
Tomorrow, panted Tassone into the ambassador's frightened eyes. 1 o'clock, Kew Gardens.
Unhand me, gasped Thorne.
5 minutes, then you'll never see me again. Your wife is in danger. She'll die unless you come.
As Thorne pulled back, the priest was suddenly gone. The ambassador was left dazed, gazing into strange faces, flashbulbs going off directly into his eyes.
Thank you.
Thorn slowly entered the park and searched for the priest. Tassone was alone on a bench, his back to him. He moved forward, circling the priest and confronting him head-on.
"Say what you have to say."
Tassone's eyes fluttered and his hands began to tremble.
"When the Jews return to Zion and a comet fills the sky and the Holy Roman Empire rises, then you and I must die. The Book of Revelations predicted it all."
"I'm not here for a religious sermon. You said my wife was in danger."
"Go to the town of Megiddo. In the old city of Jezreel, there see the old man, Bugenhagen. He alone can describe how the child must die."
"I'm here," said Thorn quietly, "because you said my wife.
I had a vision, Mr. Thorn. She is pregnant."
Thorn was stopped, taken aback.
"You're mistaken."
"He will not allow the child to be born. He will kill it while it slumbers in the womb."
"What are you talking about?"
"Your son, Mr. Thorn. The son of Satan. He will kill the unborn child and then he will kill your wife. And when he is certain to inherit all that is yours, then, Mr. Thorn, he will kill you."
Thorn shook his head, pointing a trembling finger at the priest. "I've heard you now. I want you to hear me. If ever I see you again, I'll have you arrested." Turning on his heel, he began to move away. Tassone calling after him through his tears.
"You'll see me in hell, Mr. Thorn. There we will share our sentence."
In the sunroom, Thorn and Kathy were having breakfast. Damien was noisily riding a bike around the parquet floor, bumping insistently into Kathy's chair and screaming like a train engine as he played.
"Mrs. Baylock!"
Kathy called. Thorn was seated across from her, untying the newspaper, jolted by the anger of her tone. Mrs. Baylock entered at a near run.
"Ma'am? Take him out of here."
"He's only playing," objected Thorn.
"I said take him out."
"Yes, ma'am," replied Mrs. Baylock. She took Damien by the hand, leading him from the room. As he went, the child gazed back at his mother, his eyes filled with hurt. Thorn saw it and turned to Kathy with despair. She continued eating, avoiding his eyes.
"We have a problem, Robert."
"Yes."
"I want no more children. Ever."
Thorn searched her face, waiting for more.
"Is that all right?"
"If that's what you want," he replied.
"Then you'll agree to an abortion. I'm pregnant. I found out yesterday morning."
Thorn was ashen, and his hands trembled as he stared at the table. Beside him, the phone rang, and mechanically he picked it up. He paused, not recognizing the voice.
"What? Who is this?"
The caller hung up. Thorn's eyes were filled with alarm.
"What was it?"
asked Kathy.
"Something about the newspapers. Some person just called me and said to read them today."
He looked down at the folded newspaper in front of him and slowly opened it. His eyes fell on a photo on the front page.
"What is it? What's wrong?"
But he was unable to reply and she took it from him, finding the object of his gaze. It was a photo of a priest impaled on a window pole. The banner beneath it reading, "Priest crucified in bizarre tragedy." Kathy looked at her husband and saw that he was shaking. Thorn rose stiffly and began to move out of the room.
"Did you know him?"
asked Kathy. But he never replied. Kathy looked again at the photo, and as she read the article, she heard Thorn's car starting, disappearing down the drive. Kathy busied herself with household duties. She stood now on the second floor landing with a pitcher in hand, wondering how to reach the plants that hung suspended just over the balcony. Behind her, in his playroom, Damien rode his bike, making the sound of a freight train, the sound intensifying as he rode faster. In the hallway, Kathy stepped up onto a stool. Damien accelerated and shot outward from his room.
his bike colliding with Kathy, sending her flying, clawing air as she toppled into space. By the time Thorne got to the hospital, the reporters were already there, shouting questions and popping flashbulbs into his eyes. He pushed through to intensive care. A doctor appeared, quickly walking toward him.
"Is she all right?" Thorne asked.
"She'll recover. She has a concussion, a broken collarbone, and some internal bleeding."
"She's pregnant."
"I'm afraid not. You do know she jumped."
"Jumped?"
"From your second floor balcony, apparently in full view of your child and his nanny." Thorne arrived home after midnight. A phone was ringing and he raced to his bedside to pick it up.
"Hello.
It's Jennings. I'm in Chelsea and I think you'd better meet me here right away. Something's happening that you ought to know." Jennings entered his darkroom, gesturing Thorne to follow. He turned on a small lamp, spotlighting a group of photos. On top was a shot of the small priest, Tassone. Thorne turned to him with dismay.
"Where did you get this?"
"Took it."
"I thought you were looking for this man. You said you were related to him."
"Just look at the picture."
"That shadow over his head?" asked Thorne.
"Yes." "Then look at this." Jennings removed the photo and replaced it with the one carried on the front page of the newspapers. The priest impaled on the spear-like pole. Thorne sat stunned.
"I can't explain it either," said Jennings. "That's why I started digging."
Taking a pair of tongs, he turned to a tray, lifting out an enlargement, waving slightly to let it drip before moving it to the light. "I've got some friends at the police. They gave me some negatives." As Thorne's eyes fell on the enlargement, he winced. It was in three separate panels, each a different death pose of the priest's naked body. "His body was completely normal," continued Jennings, "except for one small item on the inside of his left thigh." He handed Thorne a magnifying glass, guiding his hand to the last panel. Thorne looked closely, seeing the mark. It looked like a tattoo.
"What is it?" asked Thorne.
"Three sixes. 666. Jennings swiveled in his chair and opened a drawer, producing a tattered folder. "The police dismissed him as a kook, let me rummage through and take what I wanted." Jennings rose and moved into the living room, Thorne following. There, the photographer upended the folder, spilling its contents onto the table. He sifted through the items, flicking on a bare bulb that hung suspended overhead. He found a newspaper clipping and handed it to Thorne. "It's from a magazine called Astrologer's Monthly, a report by an astrologer of what he calls an unusual phenomenon, a comet that took the shape of a glowing star, like the Star of Bethlehem 2,000 years ago." Thorne studied the article, wiping perspiration that formed on his upper lip. "Only this one happened just 4 years ago. June the 6th, to be exact. Does that date ring a bell?"
"Yes," answered Thorne hoarsely.
"Then you recognize this second clipping," replied Jennings, lifting another scrap from the pile. "It's from a newspaper in Rome. It's the birth announcement of your son. That was also June the 6th, 4 years ago. I'd call that a coincidence, wouldn't you?" Thorne's hands were trembling now, the papers fluttering so he could barely read. "Was your son born at 6 a.m? Thorne turned to him, his eyes filled with anguish. "I'm trying to figure out the mark on the priest's thigh, the three sixes. I think it relates to your son. The sixth month, the sixth day."
"My son is dead," blurted Thorne. "I don't know whose son I'm raising."
"If you wouldn't mind, Mr. Thorne," said Jennings quietly, "I'd like to help you find out."
"No," groaned Thorne. "This is my problem."
"You're wrong, sir," replied Jennings sadly. "It's my problem too." Thorne turned to him and their eyes held, Jennings slowly moving into the dark room and reappearing with a final photograph in his hand. "There was a small mirror in the corner of the priest's room," said Jennings with difficulty. "Happened to catch my own reflection in it when I took one of the pictures." Thorne's eyes moved to the photo and his face registered shock. There was something missing. It was Jennings' neck. The head separated by a blemish of haze from his body. It was raining in Rome, the thunder rumbling ominously above them. They made it to a waiting cab and moved slowly through a downpour toward the other side of town.
Ospedale di Santo, said the cab driver as he came to an abrupt stop.
This isn't it, Thorne said.
Sì, Ospedale di Santo.
No, è differente.
Ah, replied the driver. Fuoco, molte morte.
Inside the hospital, Thorne found an English-speaking nun who confirmed that a fire 3 years ago had reduced the old building to ruins. There was a priest, a giant of a man.
Spileto?
Yes, replied Thorne excitedly. Spileto is he.
He lived.
The monastery of Santa Benedictus was stark and Gothic upon a hill. We don't know if he can see or hear, said a monk who stood over Spileto in the monastery courtyard. Since the fire, he has not made a sound. We pray for his recovery when his penance is complete. Penance? Asked Thorne. The monk nodded. He's fallen from grace. For abandoning Christ. Come with me. Spileto's cubicle was bare and box-like, containing only a straw mattress and a table made of stone. It's drawn on the table, said the monk as they entered. He wrote it out in coal. Spileto's wheelchair clattered as it crossed the uneven stones, and they gathered around the small table, seeing there the strange symbol the priest had drawn. He did it when he first came here, said the monk. We left the coal here on the table, but he has drawn no more. It was a grotesque stick figure. What immediately caught Jennings' eye were the three numerals over the stick figure's head.
What about the sixes? Asked Jennings.
Six is the sign of the devil.
Why three of them?
We believe it signifies the diabolical trinity.
Thorne glanced at Spileto and shuddered at the glistening, frozen face.
Father Spileto, he said firmly, my name is Thorne. The priest stared mutely upward, unmoving, unhearing.
It's no use, advised the monk,
but Thorne would not be stopped. Father Spileto, there was a child. I want to know where that child is from. Thorne shouted into the mute, unmoving face. I beg you, where is she?
And suddenly they were jarred, the very atmosphere thundering around them as the monastery bells began to peal. Then Thorne looked down and saw it. The priest's hand was beginning to tremble and slowly rise.
The coal, shouted Thorne. Give him the coal!
Jennings' hand moved quickly, grabbing the lump of coal from the table and thrusting it into the trembling hand. As the bells continued to peal, the priest's hand jerked stiffly across the stone, forming crude letters that wavered with each impact of the deafening sound. Jennings' feet were two graves, dug close together, side by side. Unlike the others in the cemetery, these were fairly recent, one full-sized, the other small, the headstones unadorned, bearing only names and dates.
See the dates? Asked Jennings. June the 6th, 4 years ago.
Thorne approached slowly and stood beside him, staring down at the mounds.
They're the only recent ones in the whole place. The others are so old you can't even read them.
Thorne knelt, wiping dirt from the headstone so he could see what was inscribed. Jennings knelt beside him, surprised to find that his companion was in tears.
This is it, moaned Thorne. I know it. My child is buried here.
And likely the woman who gave birth to the one you're raising. Thorne looked into Jennings' eyes.
Maria Santoya, said Jennings,
pointing to the headstone.
There's a mother here and a child. Thorne shook his head, trying to make sense of it.
But why here? Why in this terrible place?
There's only one way to find out, Thorne. We've come all this way. We might as well do it.
Jennings raised the tire iron, plunging it forcefully into the earth. Within half an hour, they were covered with soot and perspiration, clearing the last bits of earth from two cement covers. They sat back on their knees and stared at them, assessing what next had to be done.
"Let's go," said Jennings. "Do the big one first."
Jennings struck hard with his tire iron, wedging it against the side of the large cement lid. Then, with great effort, he pried it upward until he could get his fingers underneath.
"Come on! God damn it!"
Jennings threw his weight against it, and the lid slowly came up. They both strained with the full force of their strength to hold it in place as their eyes searched the darkened chamber below.
My God!
It was the carcass of a jackal. Maggots and flies abounding in the decay, wriggling through bits of leathered flesh that still clung to the bones. With his mouth flying open, Thorne lurched backwards, the cement slipping from his grip and crashing downward, breaking into pieces in the crypt below. A horde of flies billowed upward, Jennings moving in sudden terror.
"Let's go."
"No,"
gasped Thorne.
"The other one. Maybe it's an animal too."
"So what?"
"Then maybe my child's alive somewhere."
Quickly retrieving the tire iron, Jennings jammed it against the smaller lid. Thorne getting his fingers beneath it as Jennings firmly pried it upward. Within the small casket was the remains of a human child, its delicate skull smashed to pieces.
"They murdered my son."
They found their way to a small hotel and signed in under false names, the concierge giving them the key to a single room. Thorne had fallen into an exhausted sleep, awakened by the phone. It was dark now and Jennings was gone.
"Yes,"
Thorne answered groggily. It was the voice of Dr. Becker, the tone of his voice betraying the news to come.
"I'm sorry to have to tell you this long distance.
What's happened?"
"Kathy jumped from her hospital window. She's dead, Mr. Thorne. We did everything we could."
At midnight, Jennings returned, his gangly form bent with exhaustion as he looked to Thorne's figure lying prone on the bed.
"Thorne?"
Thorne didn't answer, and Jennings sat heavily at the opposite side of his bed.
"I found out about the town of Megiddo. It's taken from the word Armageddon, the end of the world."
"Where is it?"
Thorne asked without expression.
"About 50 feet underground, I'm afraid, outside Jerusalem."
"I want to go there," whispered Thorne.
Jennings nodded, emitting a long sigh.
"If only you could remember the name of the old man."
"Bugenhagen."
Jennings glanced at him, still unable to see Thorne's eyes.
"Bugenhagen?"
"That was the name," replied Thorne without expression. "I've remembered it all. Everything he said."
Jennings listened intently in the darkness, finally alerted by the lifeless tone that something in Thorne had changed.
"Has something happened?" he asked.
"Kathy's dead," replied Thorne without emotion. "I want the child to die too."
The chamber was lit with dozens of hanging lanterns, the shadowed walls betraying the vague contours of buildings and stone stairwells molded directly into the rock. Bugenhagen moved behind his table and with effort sat, the light from his table lamp casting upon a complexion so pallid that it was almost transparent. His face was taut and it was bitter, as though he had no taste for what had to be done.
"What is this place?"
asked Thorne.
City of Jezreel, town of Megiddo, he replied without expression. My fortress, my prison, the place where Christianity began.
Your prison?
Geographically, this is the heart of Christianity. So long as I remain within, nothing can harm me. He paused, regarding their reaction.
The little priest, said Bugenhagen. Is he dead yet?
Yes.
Then sit down. We'd better get to work.
Thorn stared down at the table. Before him, seven stilettos were planted firmly upright, forming the sign of the cross.
It must be done on hallowed ground, whispered the old man. The grounds of a church. His blood must be spilled on the altar of God. Each knife must be buried to the hilt.
The old man's gnarled hand reached in, and with an effort unstuck the knife in the center.
The first dagger is the most important. It extinguishes physical life and forms the center of the cross. You must be devoid of sympathy. This is not a human child.
Thorn struggled to find his voice.
What if you're wrong? He asked. What if he's not?
Make no mistake. There must be some proof.
He bears a birthmark, a sequence of sixes.
Thorn's breath quickened.
No, he said. He doesn't have it.
He must have it.
I've bathed him. I've studied every inch of him.
If it is not visible on the body, you will find it beneath the hair.
On the streets of Jerusalem, they entered the narrowed sidewalk of a construction area. Thorn held up the package in his trembling hands.
These are knives, weapons. He wants me to stab him. He expects me to murder that child.
It's not a child, said Jennings.
It is a child.
Just cool off.
No,
Thorn shouted.
I won't do it.
He hurled the package of knives far beyond him where it hit a wall and bounced into an alley. Jennings moved quickly into the alley. He kicked rubble aside, spotting the small package at the base of a garbage bucket ahead. Hurrying to it, he bent over, failing to see the arm of a huge crane as it swung high overhead. Pausing for just an instant before letting loose the huge pane of glass held tightly in its grip, it sliced downward with the finality of a guillotine, catching Jennings just above the collar, neatly severing his head from his body before exploding into a million flying pieces. The child was asleep, his face peaceful and innocent, and Thorn averted his eyes, not daring to look at him again. He tightened his muscles and drew in his breath, then moved forward, a razor clutched tightly in his hand. Standing over the boy, he clicked on the razor and applied it firmly, pressing down at a point at the back of the child's skull. It was there, the birthmark, its scab-like texture torn into by the razor and bleeding now, but clearly imprinted against the white scalp at the base of his head. They were sixes, three of them, in a cloverleaf pattern with their curved tails touching in the center. The car lurched to a stop in front of the church and Thorn threw open the door. A howling wind rose up around them. The child spun in his arms and bit into his neck, Thorn screaming in pain as he fought to continue. Over the thunder came the sound of a police siren, and from the windows across the street, a man's voice shouted desperately for Thorn to let the child go. But he was unhearing as the wind howled around him and the boy tore at the flesh of his face. A finger plunged into his eye socket and Thorn fell to his knees, clinging hard as he dragged the struggling child to the threshold of the stairs. With superhuman strength, he forced the child to the ground and reached into his coat, fumbling with a package of knives. With a blood-curdling cry, Damien kicked it from his hand and the stilettos sprinkled onto the stairs around them, Thorn grabbing one while trying to hold the child in place. The police siren reached its apex and stopped, the child screaming as Thorn raised the stiletto high overhead. Stop! Shouted a voice from the street. Thorn glanced up at them, then down at the child.
and with a sudden cry of rage, plunged the knife downward, the child's scream coming simultaneously with the sound of a gunshot. In New York City, outside the cemetery gates, reporters watched and photographed through telephoto lenses. At the gravesite, the two caskets were being slowly lowered, the priest raising his arms to the sky. Within the assembled mourners, a couple stood apart from the rest, surrounded by men in plain clothes whose eyes furtively roamed the crowd. It was a man, dignified and stately, a woman in a black veil at his side, holding the hand of a four-year-old whose arm was cradled in a sling. "And as we commit Robert and Catherine Thorne to their eternal rest," intoned the priest, "we turn our eyes to their child, Damien, the sole survivor of this once great family, now moving into the household of another. May he prosper in the love they have to give. May he assume the legacy of his father and become a leader of mankind." From his position near the graves, Damien watched the two caskets descend, holding tight to the hand of the woman at his side. Four motorcycle policemen escorted the limousine outward past the line of reporters, and they snapped photographs of the child's face as it stared back at them through the rear window of the departing car. For all, the photographs would be marred by a blemish, a flaw in the film emulsion, creating a haze that hung over the car.
The Omen by David Seltzer, abridged by Jeremy Osborne, read by Owen Teale, produced by Karen Rose. A Sweet Talk production for BBC Radio 4.